Robert Henry McAnally MacDonald, my dad. I rate this man, my dad, the greatest man who ever lived. Better than Mark Boland, better than John Wayne. He was the most kindest, loving, caring and devoted father any boy or man could have wished for. He had a sense of being that was unique. There are far, far too many stories about how he showed his love towards me. I could devote a whole book to them all, if I wrote them all down, but some are carved deep down in my memory, and I have to share them so that these special ones will be remembered long after I am gone. As a boy growing up, he taught me all about football, playing the game, facts, figures. He was always buying every year the wee red book from the Evening Times, a little kind of small pocket encyclopedia of Scottish football. Apart from him reading all the various facts and scores, I used to read it for hours. It was so interesting. Such a wee small book, bustling with so much data. He would take me to the Rangers games at Ibrox at a time when you could stand and shout at your team. There never seemed to be any bigots as there is nowadays. He would lift me on his shoulders or sit me on top of the barriers. And if Rangers scored, everyone would jump up and down, but would never let me fall, but sometimes throw me up into the air and catch me again. He was always taking me to play football as well, teaching me what he knew. We would play 1v1 in Kelvin Grove Park and Kelvin Bridge. We would use two trees as goalposts and play against each other. My dad would have been in his middle 40s. He was fit as a fiddle, running, tackling, saving, but he would never let me lose. Any trophy or award I went on to win was all down to him. He was my inspiration. This great man was my rock, and even writing this, my eyes are filling up with tears as I miss him so very much. One of the biggest memories I have is when I get sent down at the age of 17. For the whole year or so that I was inside, he wrote to me every single day. Yes, every day he would write me a letter. Not just one page, but three or four pages every letter. He would write about my mum, my family, my friends, the news topics, football, and of course music. He would write down the full words of songs he knew I was interested in so I could learn them. I was the envy of a lot of the musically minded inmates. It wasn't until recently I realised just what it took for my mum and dad to come and visit me, especially as I was in Edinburgh, Stockton prison. Two bus journeys of 2 hours each way, then a train, and sometimes in the winter months, they would stay over at a bed and breakfast so they could visit me all weekend. If that's not love and dedication, I do not know what is. My dad, when I was young, would sing to me at night, and his voice, though not the greatest, was soft and gentle, and would soothe me to sleep. The ones he would sing the most was "Toora Loora Loora Lie" by Bing Crosby, from the film Going My Way. And of course, he would sing Oh My Papa by Eddie Calvert. He knew all the words to these songs. This man worked all the days into retirement, and in those jobs, he would bring me home goodies, little things I could use, play with, or to eat. Some spring to mind, when he worked in the fruit and potatoes and veg depot, he would bring me home lots of fruit and stop off by to buy me chocolate. In his work in the Anderson bus station, when he had to refill the chocolate machine or the machine was being replaced, he would bring me all sorts of chocolate bars and crisps. He was also the janitor in Woodland School, and I would have all the pencils, rubbers, rulers, books, jotters I needed. Our cupboards were full. I guess that's why I like to write and draw a lot. My dad would take me to the cinema, mainly in Crown Street and the Gorbals, the George Cinema. My mum would go to the Palace Bingo next to it. We would always go watch a film, lots of Western films starring John Wayne. The film would always finish before my mum's bingo came out, and my dad and I would play Pavey. This was a game where you kicked an empty cigarette packet or matchbox along the ground, and you had to make it stop or land in the joint of the paving stones, and you would get a point every time. Not as easy as it sounds. We played this a lot and for long times, as sometimes my mother would be late coming out of the bingo, or if she was collecting her winnings or playing the snowball. That was a game played after the ordinary bingo was played. She was usually out by 10:30 or 11 o'clock at night. I was a little tired, but my dad kept me busy playing and chatting. In later life, he was a very simple man. He would just sit in his armchair with many cups of tea and many cigarettes. He would still doodle and draw on bits of paper, wee shapes and things. Perhaps now and then, if my mum wasn't hogging the telly, he would watch one of his films. He loved James Cagney, Humphrey Bogart, gangster films and westerns, and John Wayne, of course, was his idol. Imagine my surprise when the cover of the Zip Gun Boogie album by T-Rex, Mark Bolan was to have on the back cover James Cagney and Humphrey Bogart. Coincidence? I think not. He eventually never bothered with the TV, except he was down at my house watching the Rangers play. When Rangers scored, everyone would jump about, shout, etc. But my dad remained calm and drank his tea with a smile. In his house, he would mainly listen to the radio, which I bought him and still have to this day. And I hope one of my sons or daughters will continue to keep this and look after this keepsake. He would listen to his favourite music, Bing Crosby being his favourite, and of course Radio Scotland for the live football commentary on a Saturday afternoon. In the last days of my dad's time here on earth, he was kind of frail and weak. He took a mini stroke which left him blind in one eye, but he was still strong enough not to ask for help if he needed it. He was a proud man and knew his pride was being tarnished due to his weak state. Unstable some days, and some days he struggled to eat, wash or dress himself. He was hurting at this being done for him. Perhaps in a way he told me this, that his time was nearly up. 2 weeks before he was taken, he said to me in his bedroom, "You son should not be left to do these things for me." I told him it was not a problem, that I would move the earth and stars for him, that I love him so much. I was glad a few months earlier when my dad could read properly. I had written him a very, very long sentimental letter explaining how much he meant to me, and we talked about the letter. He was pleased I took the time to write my feelings towards him. It was always hard for us to speak face to face about our feelings as we got older, but I guess this was a man's type of thing, so the letter was really important to him. That terrible morning when I got a phone call from his home help to say my dad had fallen on the floor and they couldn't get him up, I rushed round. It took me about 6 minutes, but it seemed like an eternity. When I got there, my dad was still on the floor and an ambulance had been called. My son Mark was in the next room asleep. The home help never even knew he was in there. I battered Mark's locked door to tell him what was happening. We were trying to speak to him, but we were not getting through. I kept my mum in the living room. She was too helpless to assist, as her blindness and deafness would not have helped. The ambulance seemed to take forever. I kept going outside to look down the street for it. I was panicking. They eventually came, took him to the Southern General, which is now has the most stupid name, the Queen Elizabeth University Hospital. I followed the ambulance in my car, not caring that I went through red lights. After they assessed the situation, I was told there was nothing that could be done. But my dad actually held on to life for nearly 2 weeks after they said that. While I have the most respect for nurses and doctors, it is my belief, and I sincerely mean this, that when you reach a certain age, hospitals do not give their full commitment to you. I believe you are left to pass away without them fully trying. Yes, they will try for younger, but for the aged, they don't know to try. Maybe it's the rules, maybe it's secret rules, I don't know. But I believe this be the case. All my sons and daughters and my mum went up to visit him as he lay in the hospital ward. I had just got in from being at the hospital about 8 o'clock from visiting him when I received the phone call I was dreading. They told me he'd passed away. I had to go straight away to break the news to my mum. When I did, she screamed, "Not my Bobby, not my Bobby." I phoned the family. I got my mum ready and went back up to the hospital. This was the saddest day of my life. All those around the bed wept uncontrollably. Robert and Debbie, Mark and Tracy. After everyone left, I kissed his head, told him I loved him. I'm crying as I write this. He was my world, my hero. Arranging his funeral was so hard, as with every detail I dealt with, made my heart sink and my eyes swell with tears. Everyone did their best to help, but I felt I had to do the important things on my own. He was my dad, and I wanted him to be proud of me. When I went to collect a certificate to take to John Street from the hospital on the way back, I could not hold back the lump in my throat. It was hurting me. And as I went to John Street to collect another certificate, I was so overcome by grief, I cried out loud. I had to pull the car over. I could not see the road for my tears. I thought my heart was going to break in pieces as I realised I could not speak or see to him ever again. He was gone. And I longed for him to be alive. I knew I had to pull myself together as things, important things needed to be done, taken care of. I was making sure everyone was able to say their farewells and be there also for my mum and family to give them what support I could. I wanted to make sure the most decent, respectful and dignified send-off he would have. Although I could hear him in my head saying, "Och, just bury me round the back." I was making sure he had the best suit on. The things of a personal nature was placed inside his coffin. His favourite songs were played. I tried my very best for him, as he did for me, bringing me up, teaching me and moulding me into the man I am. I have many flaws in me, but if there's any good in me, it was this man who put it there. In memory of my dad, I try and keep his graveside tidy. There's a photograph of him and my mum on the gravestone, which I look at when I go up to the place. Flowers are tidy up. He also has a brick at Ibrox, the Brimlone Road end, where I've took the boys up to show them. I don't think many of the family have been up to see the brick, but his name's there and it'll be there forever. And it was something he was quite proud of having. Love you, Dad. Rest in peace.